Well, let's do this. I am Jason Sullivan. Welcome to Paranormal Uncensored, only on liveparanormal.com. Thanks for coming on tonight. We're going to talk about a subject. Since Halloween is right around the corner, it's one of the most popular emails I get, one of the most popular subjects I have to go over with people, so might as well make it a show. And that is, what makes a haunt? Okay? And what I mean by that is, what makes a location, a place, a person, an inanimate object, whatever it may be, haunted? There has to be something that ties into it. Do you know what I'm saying? There has to be something more to it. Now, of course, everything we're going to talk about is theory. And then again, I could say everything we're going to talk about is philosophy. But the idea is that there is more behind it than it is what it is because it is. That doesn't make any sense. I know a lot of people are watching TV as of late and watching all the ghost hunting shows. The new shows that are coming on have really gotten bad. But the point is that people want to know why places are haunted. Well, let's get into it. Let's talk about what could make a haunt. If we had a location, what could possibly make a place haunted? Now, I'm basing this, what I have tonight, what I'll go over, on observation and experience, okay? These are things out of my own personal little journal. So these are observations I've made while doing investigations in the paranormal field that I believe would make a place haunted. All right, you may have your own versions to this, your own twist. Doesn't mean anyone's wrong, because it is kind of all a guessing game. More experimentation would need to be done on specific areas of the paranormal field to start making applications to try to make paranormal law, basically. Law meaning that it is that because it is. Not, you know, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. The same thing applies in science. There are scientific laws and there's theory and hypothesis. Basically, a theory and hypothesis, until proven, are just theories and hypotheses. And once they're proven, it's a law. You know, so, well, anyway, let's talk about the first thing. First thing I could say for what makes a haunt would have to be the location. The actual location itself on the planet could make a big difference. Now, I don't mean it has to be in China, has to be in Tennessee, you know, it has to be in Canada. What I'm saying is the location is very important, meaning that the natural landscape has a lot to do with it. Okay, the water, the minerals which are in the soil, the electromagnetic fields. Sometimes you could be near fault lines. Fault lines give off a strong electromagnetic field, and you might find yourself, you know, in a situation where you have plenty of paranormal activity, but no one ever reports a haunt because it's so common. And people who live near fault lines are usually these people. Okay, people who live near fault lines always say, well, there's objects on my shelf that just move. Well, yeah, it's called an earthquake. But that's neither here nor there. But anyway, the location will make a difference, okay? Now, you want to look for low electromagnetic fields. And what I mean by that is something that is natural in its environment, not unnatural, meaning that there's a power company who put a power station in there. There are power lines and transformers everywhere. You know, you're under power lines, you turn on an electromagnetic field reader, it goes off the charts, and it doesn't even want to shut off. That's a good example. You're looking for areas that do not have that, or have insulated underground wires. All the electricity has been put underground. It's another good example. But I mean, you want to look for an environment that is very natural. Okay, very real, very untouched, comes in very handy, okay? The other thing is the history. The history of the land itself, its impact on its environment. Basically, when you look at certain haunts, and since the majority of haunts, by my estimation, are nothing more than spiritual imprinting, okay, residual, they're just imprinted events that are triggered by people interacting with the environment. Okay, that's all they are. But the history of that land can make the difference on what history is available? What imprints on the environment are available to be triggered to give us paranormal activity? People who go to Gettysburg and look at reenactments, and then they see other soldiers at Gettysburg that aren't a part of the reenactments. People who go to different cemeteries, and they can see everything from old soldiers to people who have passed away in the cemetery, or at least they claim to. Right? These are all very interesting things. The history of the land can play a huge part. The more history, the more interaction of human events that has taken place in places will give you more chances to have imprints on the environment, more chances for residual energy to take place. If you want to discover extremely haunted locations, or at least have your best chance of experiencing paranormal activity, you would probably go to the East Coast versus the West Coast. This is because the majority of the history happened in the original colonies. And there are plenty of areas which are still very natural, okay, that can offer a paranormal environment, you know, where you can actually see events, or you can actually try to trigger events in order to witness previous events of the past from the spiritual imprinting. It's very interesting. The history of the land is extremely important when it comes to what makes a haunt. The other thing is staying original. That's probably the hardest part. Now, believe it or not, your normal home, an environment, or a business could have spiritual imprinting. It could have residual energy. There's no paranormal activity. No one's ever saw a ghost or anything. But things can happen. There was one day when I was at my own job, and I work in a building that was built in the mid-80s. And when I opened up the door to walk into the hallway, just for an instant, I could have swore I saw somebody drinking at the water fountain. Just for an instant. And I don't know. I mean, it was like, did I imagine it? Was it a flash in my memory? And then I thought about it later on, and I'm like, that's pretty cool. That was a pretty cool event. I mean, it was an imprint on the environment. It's very possible that at that particular moment, there was a trigger of the event, and I got a very faint but quick glimpse. That's it. And all it was somebody drinking at the water fountain. Now, this is a normal building. Okay, this isn't something special. This is something out of the ordinary. It's a normal building. Very cool. But staying original, okay, that's important. Our building really hasn't had a makeover in a long time. Let's take people who have their homes, they buy an old home. A lot of people have paranormal activity take place when they start gutting a house and rehabbing it. It's not uncommon. It's actually the most popular, I would say, events of paranormal activity that ever take place are when people are working on their homes. These are normal people who aren't into the paranormal field. These are people who don't care, never seen it on TV, don't believe it, okay? And then they're gutting their hallway and putting a new drywall. And they have tools fly down the stairs. They've had drywall rip off the wall. Stacks of things that they put up, tile, whatever, pushed over, knocked down. Strange noises, strange voices, all taking place while they're trying to rehab the home. Hold on a second. That vibration on the camera is from this little kitty who keeps sitting in front of the keyboard. Sorry about that. But anyway, but it happens all the time. People start rehabbing their homes, and all of a sudden, there's all this paranormal activity, which it kind of excites me, because Lynette and I are in the process right now of purchasing a new home, and we plan on doing quite a bit of rehabbing on this house. And I am really looking forward to some residual energy spiking left and right in this home. The home was built in 1940. You want to say hi to the camera? See, look at it. She's right back there again. The house was built in 1941. It's got great history. It's part of the historical district where we're buying our house. So, I mean, it's just what we want. And it fits, you know, like the demographic of what could make a haunt based on the rehabbing of a home and paranormal activity taking place from residual energy. Anyway, Hold on here. Sorry, I'm very, very full. I ate a lot of spaghetti. So, if any of you who have ever rehabbed a house or have friends, okay, who are working on homes, that might be your chance or opportunity to ask them if anything's going on. Have they seen anything? Because, you know, guys, let's admit it. A lot of people who witness, experience paranormal activity don't say anything. They're very quiet about it. They don't want to share it. Sometimes they think people are just going to think they're nuts. All right, so they keep it to themselves and nobody talks about it. That's an opportunity for you to ask. If you're into this field, if you're in it as a novice, as most are, and you want to just experience residual energy, that would be your opportunity. Interview those people, find out what are working. Hey, and get off your ass and maybe go help drywall. Go help gut the house, carry garbage out. You never know if you're going to be there the moment something takes place. And if an event's going to trigger, you're going to want to be there. Am I right? Mogwai, keep your foot off my keyboard. So, right. The other way we look at a house and what could possibly make it haunted would be the idea that there are no people, or at least very little. We are doing it now, Jason. So Brenda knows what I'm talking about. Gutter house, have a camera. Brenda, have a camera ready. You know. Yeah. We'll always have a camera ready, a video camera. You never know. Or at least document on a piece of paper things that take place so you can at least talk about it later. One thing is the people. How many people inhabit the location? You know, how busy is it? There's a reason, okay, that all these old abandoned homes, old country homes, houses in the middle of nowhere, end up being the haunted house. There's a reason, okay? If some people want to say, oh, it's because a victim suffered there. Oh, it's because if somebody was killed there. Oh, you know what? There's a lot of factors that can take place when it comes to excited emotion leaving an imprint on its environment to haunt it. Suffering always isn't going to be it. I mean, people always think that a haunt is going to be created. No offense to those who don't. People always think that a haunt is created because, ooh, somebody died there, somebody suffered there. Those are strong emotions. Somebody suffers, somebody is dying. But you know what else is a very strong emotion? Love. Okay? Love is an extremely strong emotion. How many hauntings do we have anywhere where a couple got married? Right? I would think that would leave a pretty strong imprint on its environment. Or what about a mother who gave birth in her home? Okay, and is holding her baby for the first time. Would you say there's a strong emotional tie there? Something that is as strong as somebody suffering? Very strong, right? See, there are other emotions that will definitely help in haunting an environment. And it is ignorant as a paranormal investigator, a ghost hunter, whatever you'd like to call yourself, a researcher, to think that only a negative emotion would impact the environment to make it haunted. Okay? Listen to Lynette. She's already planning on haunting me. And I know I'm not going to die first. So, I mean, we all know it's going to be a... Anyway. But very little people. Okay? An uninhabited environment, or at least a very neutral environment. You know, one that has a small family, you know, around there. And plus, there's a connection. You never know if the conscious energy, our ghost, is connected to the land itself or the environment. You know, let's say American Indians who've had their tribe on a land for hundreds of years, or a family member who's passed away had a strong signature on the environment, and the same family lives on the same farm. You know, a lot of these things can play a factor. As long as the environment is friendly to that conscious energy and makes it comfortable enough to not only survive there, but to inhabit, it's very possible that could create a haunt. I'm coming to haunt you when I pop me clogs. I have no idea what that means. Anyway. But you see what I mean? Die. Oh, yeah. One of those Brits. Another thing that really can help haunted environment is something that I've come across on investigations. And here's what I mean by this. On several investigations, when talking to families, when they're describing what the haunt is, regardless of what it is, regardless if they see something, hear something, something was moving, it doesn't matter. There's a location. There's almost always a general location of where the haunt takes place, right? This isn't uncommon at all. I mean, everyone will say, this room's haunted. This area's haunted. In the foyer over there, I keep seeing something. You see what I mean? So, this factor comes into play in all these investigations, and there had to be something the same. After reviewing and cross-referencing information, here's what I found. Low pulse electromagnetic fields. Low pulse. Okay, low pulse. And here's how this can happen. I found a lot of homes with ungrounded outlets, and they had electronics plugged into them. If you have a radio and it's plugged into a wall, the electric socket works fine. It's just not grounded. When you turn the radio off, and if you use your electromagnetic field reader, you'll see there's still a current, and it gives off a very low pulse electromagnetic field. A low pulse electromagnetic field, in theory, is that it's like a feeding trough for a conscious energy, a ghost. We talk about ghosts all the time, what a ghost is. One of the most agreed theories out there is that a ghost is a conscious energy. It's part of the human consciousness, which is now latched itself onto energy that was available in the environment. We have, in the paranormal field, we use electromagnetic field readers, and we look for fluctuations in the norm of electromagnetic fields to see if ghosts are present. Because in common investigations, and many investigations over the past 70 years, people who have used electromagnetic field readers at paranormal locations have found fluctuations in electromagnetic fields. Is it a documented research? No. Nobody has actually taken the time to take one electromagnetic field reader, a tri-field meter, do paranormal investigations at all haunted locations, and then document the evidence and try to create paranormal law, you know, scientific law. But, again, we're dealing with a field that has been extremely ignored in research and extremely ignored in documentation of any type of research. So I take some of the blame, as most of you should. But we're going to change that. But having a low pulse electromagnetic field in an environment seems to be a great draw for our conscious energy. In a case that I did in Plainfield, Illinois, the foyer of this one residential home was haunted. Now, it was very interesting that they had a ungrounded outlet. They had a Philco harmonic record player plugged into it. It was turned off, but of course it made the electromagnetic field readers go off. All the gauze readers and tri-field meters went off. It showed that this radio, even though turned off, gave a nice buzz of an EMF field. This is the same room where they had, they were NASCAR fans. They had those little toy NASCARs. Well, I shouldn't say little, those big toy NASCARs on shelf. They had all of them lined up, you know. And they talked about how the cars got knocked off the shelves all the time. They talked about how the dog would jump on the arm of the couch facing that foyer and barking erratically at nobody who's in there. And then, of course, the son who I had talked to had made a comment that he had walked in the kitchen, gone to the fridge to get something to eat or drink. And then when he would look across the living room towards the foyer, he had on many occasions seen a figure who he thought was a young child. And again, the room had a low pulse electromagnetic field, an ungrounded outlet, an appliance plugged in. This wasn't the first time that we came across stuff like this. But so it's very interesting that it's not the first time we came across something like this, and we have so many cross references. that it makes a very neat trigger for a haunt. And of course, a very neat thing for saying what makes a haunt, a low pulse electromagnetic field. So if you're looking to haunt your house, you may think of ungrounding one of your outlets and plugging in an electronic device that you really don't care about, but will always give off a low pulse electromagnetic field in hopes to spark paranormal activity. And any questions? No, we're all good. I'm going to keep going. All right. Another thing are critical events. Okay. Critical events, and I don't mean historical. I'm talking critical events. Remember before I was talking about emotional states on how an imprint on the environment, this is going to be your residual haunting. And people will say pain, suffering, murder, can be those imprints which, oh, Lizzie Borden killed her family and that's why it's haunted. Really? That's it? That's all anybody thinks about, huh? Just a morbid Hollywood horror that creates a haunt. But no one ever says that there was a wedding here. There was a baby born. This family loved each other. You know, hate, envy, greed, vanity, sloth. You can keep going through the seven deadly sins, basically. But emotions, any emotion, can be extremely strong, all depending on who is having it. And for whatever reason. Okay, there could be many, many reasons people are going through certain events. And those different states, those different emotions, depending on how strong they are, can definitely imprint on their environment. And what I mean by this is, think about this. You've heard this before, so I'm not saying something you probably haven't heard. When people are claiming a place is haunted, you've heard them say that the group or members of the group suffer from wild mood swings. You see what I mean? Somebody suddenly gets frighteningly angry, terrified. Somebody starts laughing or giggling hysterically. People cry. People become afraid, nervous, cautious. They act out of character from what their norm is, and they don't know why. It's like that feeling you get of being watched. Like, I just feel like I'm being watched. You know, I've tested that before. You know, we being watched. So what we did was, we took turns actually staring at each other. This is true. We took turns staring at each other, but not looking at each other. So, we took turns staring at each other. But you didn't know when I was going to look at him at all. Right, the only rule was he was supposed to guess when I may be looking. But it never worked. Never once did anyone guess correctly when one of the others was staring at him. So the feeling of being watched, I think that falls into paranoia. I hate to say it, it's true. But, what was that? Critical events. You know, when you're talking about residual energy, okay, you are talking about something I brought up before, like the holographic principle. Leonard Susskind's theory of the holographic principle. If you've never read it before, read it. Watch Through the Wormhole, the Black Hole episode, towards the end, the last 10 minutes of the episode, where Leonard Susskind goes over in fine detail about the holographic principle, and you'll see about imprinting information on the environment, and of course triggering or being able to retrieve that information and triggering those events so that boom, it happens right in front of you. Okay, it's like being in a 3D carnival. Pretty cool. But the idea that those events have to be critical, it's about emotional states, it's about consistency. Sometimes these events can be just repeated events, massively repeated, something that runs on a perfect schedule. Something that happens at the same time every day. Something that is repeated so often that it leaves that imprint in the ether. Okay? I need you to, you know, think about that. Patterns. Think about your parents. Okay? In this day and age, we're not the same as our parents. Some of us are, some of us are not. But if I think about my grandfather, And I think that he got up the same time every day. He went to work every day at the same time. He came home from work every day at the same time. Okay, it's so consistent you could set your watch by it. Or a train that runs a schedule. Okay, the same thing all the time in a set environment. These are critical events. These are things that can leave an imprint on their environment strong enough that it would have an easier trigger to interact with its environment after it's gone. Okay, so very interesting in what can make a haunt there. Something like that can be expanded on in a big way. If you go into more explanation or just more research on what I'm talking about, it could be very neat. If you live in any environment where you know trains used to run, okay, it's great research to do, to go out to interview people who live in those environments now and see if they've heard trains, see trains, felt vibrations in their homes of a train going by. You get great stories from that. Same with people by old airports and so forth. Makes a big difference, okay? Let's go to another one. Reenactments. Reenactments play a fantastic role in triggering events. They do. And reenactments do not necessarily have to be historical. If you're a researcher working on an investigation, and you are looking, or you're under the belief, you don't even have to be under the belief, you just want to try to trigger something in the environment, you may reenact an event that's taken place in that house. Let's say that, okay, let's go to the negative, the Hollywood horror movie. Let's say somebody was murdered in a home. So you and a teammate want to team up and try to reenact the murder which took place in that house, hoping to trigger paranormal activity. Or maybe you're in Graceland and you're in little Elvis's little recording studio. You know the king's been there, the king's sung there. So you decide to dress up as the king and go into recording studio and start singing In the Ghetto, hoping to trigger an event. These are all things that can take place. These are all parts. Reenactment should become part of the standard in your research as a paranormal investigator. See, when you do an investigation, you go to a place to see if it's haunted, right? You hear what the story is, you go to the place, and you go to witness it yourself. You don't drag out all your equipment, you don't do jack shit. You go there to witness the haunt. Somebody told you a story, go see if it's true. Bringing your equipment is a waste of time. Some people will say to me, well, Jason, what if something takes place? What if there's a full torsal apparition and I don't have my camera with me? Well, then the next time you come, you'll have a reason to bring your camera. Because you didn't know. What if that's the only time it happens? Well, if it's the only time it happens, do you really think you would have had your camera ready in the first place? I mean, we can go on with this forever. The point is, an investigation is for you to find out if a place is haunted. Not to document, not to do research. The second visit, third, fourth, fifth, 10th, 11th, 30th, the 100th anniversary visit to a location. You do documentation and research, okay? And that's when you go and you do reenactments. If you've done your exploration, if you've done your research, if you have done your homework on an environment, then you'll know if it's haunted or not. And you might have an idea of what history took place in that location to reenact some of the things that took place and hopefully trigger an event and make paranormal activity happen. It's part of what makes a haunt. Now, other things that could help create that haunt could be items, okay? Items that are tied to specific conscious energies or ghosts. Now, some people have seen TV shows where people collect relics and artifacts, and you know, from people who say, "Ooh, it's haunted. This doll is so scary, it's haunted." I have one of those dolls. It's downstairs in my basement, locked in a case. Got it from a house that had made the claim they had a haunt, and this little doll ended up in the middle of the room all the time. We removed the doll from the environment. Paranormal activity stopped. Kind of funny. Brought the doll home, put it in the middle of my living room floor. Nothing. Stuck it downstairs in the basement. Stuck it on a table all by itself. Nothing. Left it out for weeks. Nothing. So the conscious energy wasn't attached to the toy, but the conscious energy was attached to the toy in its environment. Once removed, paranormal activity stopped. No more haunt. See, that's the thing, guys. When you have a haunted environment, it's haunted for a reason. And another way to look at that is the reason may be because the environment is set up in a perfect way. The items in the location, the people, the way the house is built, or the location, hell, sometimes just the weather or time of the year could be perfect for triggering all those paranormal events. It's very possible that what takes place in July would not take place in July next year, because maybe the weather's different. Maybe the earth isn't on the same axis anymore. It did change when there was that earthquake in Japan. So there are so many environmental factors that take place. That's why I really tell you all the time that if somebody is advertising that their place is really haunted, I want you to second and third guess it. Okay, don't pay to go to a location. If somebody is charging a ridiculous amount for you to walk around and do an investigation, we both know that investigations are for you to see if it's haunted, not to do research. And if I'm going to charge you $50, but you have to have 10 people, and it's $50 a person, you have to have 10 people, and you're going there to see if it's haunted. You have no clue if it's haunted. Now everybody's telling you it's haunted. And the website says it's haunted because everybody knows if it's on a website, it must be real. And if you believe that, you should watch Penn and Teller's bullshit on the paranormal, where they build a fake website on a location, fill it with bullshit stories, bring in three total tools who then basically recite what they read off the website because that was their research. Do not believe what you read on a website. But the fact of the matter is that when a location is bragging and boasting on how haunted it is, if you do your homework and you keep a clear head, you'll see that the majority of these places can't be haunted. Sometimes, for the reasons for being haunted, it's like, well, it could have been haunted once, but due to the overwhelming traffic and all the people that go there, the reconstruction, the rehabbing, blah, 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 there's a very good chance that this place isn't haunted anymore. You might be wasting money. Did you ever think that if you go to a haunted place and nothing happened? Okay, because it's haunted, right? If you went to the owners and said, listen, I was here for 12 hours to investigate this haunted location. It's not haunted. I didn't see anything, hear anything, witness anything. I walked around in the dark many hours. I stood in place, I sat down, I talked out loud, I had a bag of chips and a sandwich over by the cooler. Nothing. Nothing happened. Can I have my money back? Have any of you ever had the balls to ask for your money back? See, most people who pay to go to a haunted location accept it. They accept it for what it was. They paid, they played, and they're done. But the problem is, how do you wear that? Do you then leave, and then when somebody else says, hey, have you ever been to this place? Like, oh yeah, I've been there, it's haunted. Because you paid to go, and you're afraid to tell anybody different? It's like somebody who buys a car and gets screwed over. You know, they don't want to tell anybody they got screwed at the car dealership. They tell everybody they got a great deal. How'd you do at the car dealership? Oh man, I got a great deal. Not knowing that he got cracked for $5,000. See what I mean? The guy who got ripped off the most, the guy who got screwed the biggest, he doesn't want anybody to know that. You're not going to see somebody go, yeah, I went down to Tennessee, and I went to this like top 10 reported haunted place from the Travel Channel, and man, I paid $150 to go there. Holy crap, was it haunted. It was so haunted. Or do you want to hear, you know, what's this place in Tennessee, a top 10 most haunted travel channel? Paid $150 to go there, plus gas, plus hotel, plus food. That place ain't haunted. It's a bunch of bullshit. Nothing but an old, run-down place. It ain't haunted. It's crap. Can't believe I wasted my goddamn money. Yeah, you don't hear that one, do you? You don't hear it. My favorite is all the new haunted locations. Okay? We're talking about what makes a haunt. Well, here's something that doesn't make it haunted. The fact that a place is now old, the fact that a place is now abandoned. The best part is what constitutes as old. But just because a house is abandoned, a hotel, a school, an old hospital or nursery, even a cemetery, it doesn't make it haunted. Not even the littles. And what I'm seeing now is paranormal investigators and teams are pulling their money together and they are buying locations or leasing locations. And then, of course, they create a website and they create a fan base and they start telling people it's haunted and they bring in people to do investigations and they charge $50 a head and they book their place and they offer their place for, I don't know, paranormal conventions or paranormal get-togethers, meet and greets, and hey, come to our location. And then when you're there, they want to sell you the, oh God, you go ghost hunt here, it's so haunted, oh my God. It's one of the biggest scams in the field. Very embarrassing. Now, when a place is reported haunted, you know, when people say, well, I told you what, you know, kind of makes a haunt. Some people go, well, what, how do you know it's haunted, period? Okay, what kind of evidence can someone say they interacted with their environment and it's haunted? I'm not talking about seeing a ghost. Because if you see the full torso apparition that Ray has told us about, okay, when Ray said, oh, and he's taking pictures, clicking away, the full torso apparition. If you see that, well, it's a dead giveaway. I mean, you don't really need to explain shit, do you? It's a ghost. I can see it. You can see it. It's three-dimensional, and you can see through it. Amazing. Awesome. But that really doesn't sell, does it? Because that'd be like winning a lotto ticket. That'd be like having the winning lotto ticket to see the full torso. Okay, the ghost. It'd be like the ghost suddenly popping in your camera going, ooh, scary. Okay, it's not going to happen. Now, going by what people always say, let's start with that. Strange smells. Strange smells in your house. For some reason, there are paranormal investigators that feel that this is part of a haunt. Smells that you're unfamiliar with. I suddenly smell a perfume that I've never had in my house before. I smell burning wood. I smell this. I smell that. Well, you know, smells can really carry an environment. Unless you're in an isolated environment, it's really hard to... excuse me. It's really hard to sell that one. But it is what people say. Now, to get more in-depth, this is the one I like. I've talked about this before with conscious energies, and especially people who suffer from MPDs, multiple personality disorders. But I've talked about conscious energies and human frequency and how there could be an easy pair there, you know, a relationship, a match, and that a conscious energy could find itself another host, absorb into, and find itself in a new body. Now, I'm not talking possession. I'm talking multiple personality disorder. I'm talking about two consciousnesses existing in the brain together, the dominant one being the primary, and of course the other consciousness trying to butt its way in, only if it's dominating, but of course it would do it in a situation where the other one felt it should retreat. When people are sleeping at night and a conscious energy is present, okay, we have paranormal activity, you don't know because you're sleeping. Maybe the ghost is passing by. Maybe there is a ghost in your house. You just don't know about it. When you start having dreams, strong, structured dreams, very potent, very rich. Also, you can remember them extremely well. And they are of places that you've never been. There are people in it that you've never met before. When you wake up and remember, you cannot associate the places you just dreamt about, the people that you just interacted with. None of this makes any sense. It doesn't exist anywhere in your environment. You've never seen it before. You didn't watch a movie a year ago, and suddenly it triggered a memory. These are fresh. Fresh memories. It's a possibility that a conscious energy existing catches you at a moment. So you got to remember, consciousness does not exist when you're in deep sleep. I'm not talking about REM, rapid eye movement. I'm not talking about dream state. When your body is at rest, even when it's under anesthetic, when you are at rest, consciousness is not present. That is a fact that has been tested. Okay, Stuart Hofstetter has tested it. He's an anesthesiologist. He's shown people that it's not there by doing what he called the bell ringing test, where he actually had electrodes attached to someone's brain. And when they were awake, he turned it on, just a quick spark, and you watched the whole inside of the brain become active as the bell would ring, so to speak. And then he did it when they were asleep in an unconscious state, basically. Excuse me, I'm sorry. Another cat? I don't think so. You guys, this is ridiculous. Come on. Too many cats in this room. But in this state, the consciousness doesn't exist. When you're asleep, when you're under anesthetic, there is no consciousness whatsoever. So it's possible. This is when our conscious energy finds it very inviting to absorb in, to get to reset itself deep inside your own consciousness. And when you hit that dream state, a flood of memories, a flood of people, destinations, everything that you've, someone else's life starts to play in your brain while you're sleeping. It's pretty cool, actually, when you think about it. Scary at the same time. You know, to know that at a certain state when you're sleeping, you're vulnerable. If you have an extremely similar frequency to another conscious energy that may find you inviting. So, it's got its good and bad, you know what I'm saying? So, we talked before about that feeling of being watched. There's more to it, okay? If you think about it, there are people who have had, I've had this experience myself. There are people who have had experiences where they're walking up the stairs. Or for me, it would be walking up out of my basement. And I have this overwhelming feeling that I need to move. I need to go fast. It's as if I'm being pushed. It's as if I'm being coaxed. But I am being chased out, so to speak. You know, it's almost like somebody's moving right up behind you. Like you feel it. Somebody's coming right up on you. And you close your door. And it's gone. You've seen it in movies. You know, you've seen it in movies where the victim doesn't even know that the stalker's right behind them. And all of a sudden, they walk in the house and the door closes right in the stalker's face. You know, but it gives you that sense, that feeling, that eeriness that something's creeping up behind you. I think that same paranoia is what we find when we believe that we're being watched. That uneerie feeling that something left, right, or from behind us is just staring us down. Same paranoia, same idea. Another thing that's talked about is the fluctuation of temperature. Now, the fluctuation of temperature can be real interesting because it goes to both sides of the spectrum. I have listened to paranormal investigators for years. It's changed that. A decade now. Talk about it only gets cold. Ever since the movie Sixth Sense came out with Bruce Willis, all people talk about is, oh, it must be haunted. It's very cold. If anybody is familiar with James Clerk Maxwell, he was a mathematician, a physicist. He actually created a fabulous mathematical solution which gave us the answer to electromagnetic fields, and more importantly, current, and how flowing electricity creates electromagnetic fields. And he wrote out the formula for this. James Clerk Maxwell would really laugh at the air temperature only being cold. When you have flowing electricity, you have electromagnetic fields. You have heat. Okay? If anybody knows anything about temperature, if we're going to just talk about atoms and excited states, let's talk about it blandly. I mean, if I hold up my little drinking glass here, this cup is not moving. So, it's cool. Now, let's start moving it rapidly. Fast. Very fast. The more excited I can make this, the hotter it'll become. The friction alone, no matter how minute, will change the temperature. When I have an electromagnetic field, a conscious energy, which is moving around the room, creating an electromagnetic field and moving, it'll be raising the temperature in its environment. That conscious energy will be absorbing all electrostatic, even possible thermal energy in the room, depending on what type of conscious energy it is. I guess if the conscious energy was in a state where all it did was absorb thermal energy, somebody would come about saying, I felt cold, because their body temperature, the heat was being drawn in and converted to energy. So there's that possibility. But if the ghost is moving, present, and very active in its environment, the fluctuation in temperature should be warm, not cool. I think that is something that we should look for. Okay. How about moving objects? You know, I've told people before, you know, if you're in a house and it's haunted, and you see a coffee cup go from the cabinet and float all the way over to the countertop, that's a pretty good sign. Unless you've developed telekinesis in some way, and you're not really sure how you did it. It's the cat. And anything moving all by itself, and there's no earthquake present, okay, it didn't fall off, no wind, no way that it was structurally just sitting the wrong way and eventually fell. You know, sometimes people think that a picture that falls off their wall, it was knocked off the wall. Then they examine further and find out that the clip or the nail that they had in the wall gave, the cable broke on the back of the picture, things like that. Sometimes there are very easy explanations for things that you'll understand. It has nothing to do with the paranormal. But a moving object, a floating object, something that drifts across and breaks Newtonian physics of gravity, well, then that's a different story. If you see something being thrown, let's say a towel, or you see someone's coat lift from the bottom back all the way up over their head, or my favorite one for all those people out there who claim that they've been thrown across a room. Yeah. Thrown. I had a 250-pound man tell me he was thrown 30 feet across the room that was about 20 feet wide. Still trying to figure out that one. Doesn't take a brainiac to figure out that if the room is 20 feet wide, you can't be thrown 30 feet. Just pointing it out. Unless he was measuring his arc and everything. It's a bunch of horse shit. But anyway, moving objects that are moving all by themselves, obviously, paranormal. I mean, if you were looking and you're like, oh my God, did you see the cup? It was floating all by itself. Maybe there's an explanation. There's a hand attached to it. Oh my God, it's a ghost hand. Sarcasm is the best chasm. Now let's get into my favorite one. The reason this is going to become my favorite is because it seems to be the most popular on television now and when other ghost shows will come out. Being touched by a ghost. This has become outlandish, ridiculous, embarrassing, stupid, idiotic, clown-like. It makes you feel like a tool. It makes you look like a tool. You must be a tool. Being touched by a ghost. And there's no proof to it. There's no valid proof to it because I felt something squeeze my thigh. Really? A conscious energy squeezed your thigh. We're talking about something that's made up of raw energy. It's not insulated like you are as a human being. You have this wonderful organ that surrounds your biochemical electrical body, the skin. And of course, when you touch something, you might get a static discharge from rubbing your feet on the ground, but for the most part, you can pretty much touch anything and you're not going to hurt it. But we take a conscious energy, something that is supposedly made up of a human consciousness that has attached itself onto another form of energy to exist in its environment, and now it's going to go over by you. It's going to place its electromagnetic field in the shape of a hand around your thigh, and then it's going to apply pressure. It has no muscles, no tendons. It has no solid state. It is not a macroscopic object. It is micro. And it is going to apply enough pressure that you're going to know somebody's squeezing you. And at the same time, you can't see it. Huh. Sorry about that. When Lynette say out some script, yep, to lower right corner of your screen. Huh. Don't know what she's talking about. It's Lynette's typing stuff in her room, but she's having her own thing. I have no idea what's going on. She's a crazy person. But in all the shows, people are talking, I'm scratched. I've been scratched. I've been pushed. There was a pinched pitcher going around today. I was pinched. Poked. Think about this. I had somebody tell me once that ghosts, when you come across a violent ghost, TK, you'll love this. You'll come across a violent ghost, right? You know it's violent because it attacks you. You know, when my nephew was really little, he used to think it was funnier than hell to kick somebody in the balls. I don't think that's funnier than hell at all. But anyway, I was the recipient of said joke. Well, let's say the unfortunate happened and my nephew died young. And my nephew, in his conscious energy state, decided that as a ghost, well, he still thought it was funnier than hell to kick people in the balls. So the place that he's haunting, he swifts kicked men in the nuts. Men fall to the ground holding themselves, and they believe that there's a demon haunting the environment because he keeps punching them in the nuts. Or kicking them in the nuts. Not that it's some like 6-year-old kid that became a ghost that just thinks it's hilarious to hit people in the balls. There was a friend of mine who was at the Hannah House, Indianapolis, Indiana. She was wearing jeans. Obviously, they weren't belted very well because when she bent over, her underwear would come out. She was upstairs in the attic of the Hannah House and she was squatted over something with her thong exposed to the world and snap, right on the back of her butt. She claims that there was nobody within 15 feet of her. Has no idea what happened. See what I mean? again, the only evidence we have is that person who experienced it. It's not on video. Not, see, that's the problem, TK. See, it's not on video. I don't have, you know, somebody getting hit in the nuts on video by a ghost. A thong being snapped on a butt by a ghost. Although, I can turn on probably any ghost show that will be airing from now to the end of the year, and I can watch people getting snapped. Or snapped. Sorry. Scratched. I did not realize that so many ghosts out there needed manicures. They have extremely sharp claws. Really sharp claws. I mean, and most of them were like three. I suggest that if you are watching any paranormal television show between now and forever, that you wear waders. Because that's how deep the shit will get. I don't want you to get any of it on you. Remember, guys, television is for entertainment purposes. Sometimes something can be there for educational purposes, but when you use stunt coordinators, have a big budget, and you are there to entertain, you have a producer, a director, you have people who handle makeup and costume, special effects artists, all working on set, or maybe you're just a film student who decided you can do it all yourself. It's entertainment. 100% thoroughbred entertainment. Okay? Ghost shows are as real as watching Two and a Half Men. Okay? There's a good example. But getting back to what we were talking about, you know, I talked about being touched. If you are really touched by conscious energy, by a ghost, I've described this before. I believe that if you were actually touched in the raw sense, that a conscious energy actually grasped you, that it would look very similar to an electrical burn. You know, if raw electricity, if you had a Jacob's ladder, I don't know if you're familiar with what a Jacob's ladder is, you can Google it. But if I stuck my arm between the two prods of a Jacob's ladder and let the electricity flow up and hit my skin, that would be as real as it can get. And it would possibly leave an electrical burn on my arm. If you Google electrical burns, okay, I do believe this word entertainment is being used rather loosely. It's as loosely as it can come. Hey, there's nothing wrong with comedy dramas, nonfiction. We can bash these things all night. It's not worth it. Entertain. Oh, she's funny. But electrical burns would be more the touch of a ghost. I'm not suggesting that any of you frauds out there go out and start burning yourself and creating electrical burns so you can prove a point. Oh my God, I've been touched by a ghost. Look, it looks like an electrical burn, just like that dude said on the radio thing, and all of a sudden I know it's real because it looks like what he said, and it's not a silly scratch like the TV shows that I know are faking it, so yeah, I got the real thing. Don't do that. Right. Other things when we're talking, I talked about mood behaviors with people when they're in a haunted environment, people going through different mood swings. The other thing is if you have animals or people have animals in their environment, it's really important to pay attention to those. Give you an example, real location, friends of mine who live over in Orland Park, Illinois, married couple who took in their dad. He was extremely sick. He was an old gentleman. He was an old dude. Well, he passed away. And not even 2 weeks after the funeral and wake, there was a situation that took place with his daughter, who lived in the house. And her dog was in the hallway, sitting and barking at a location. And what I mean by location is the dog was in the middle of the hall, slightly facing the wall, slightly facing into the hallway, as if somebody was standing there barking. The woman stared, the woman looked. There was absolutely nothing in the environment. The dog wasn't looking down. The dog was not looking at the wall. The dog was looking up. She stared. Nothing. Then for some reason, she decided to say, "Dad, I'm okay. Dad, it's okay. We'll be fine." And the dog, in seconds, stopped barking immediately, started sniffing around the location, looked back at her for like approval or what fuck, and then walked away. Paranormal activity. Very cool. Takes place. It doesn't have to be this overwhelming example of a haunt. You know what I mean? It doesn't have to be this ridiculous, oh, the picture spun on the wall, my friend floated off the ground 5 feet, saw this lamp go across the room, and oh, by the way, a ghost stuck their finger in my butt. I mean, it doesn't have to be this ridiculous. Paranormal activity can happen in the most minute senses. You just have to be able to grasp it, to understand it, to see it. You know, Kim, when she was in her house, her dad had passed away, she understood what may be taking place. She addressed it, and it stopped. Instantaneous. That is a great story. One of my favorites I've ever heard was somebody realizing what might be going on, addressing the situation, and watching it stop. An interaction in the environment from either residual or a conscious energy that was just enough to interact or cause the dog to try to interact with that conscious energy. And a person walking in on that situation, witnessing it, and actually being able to end the event. That a reassurance or an overconfidence or maybe just a frequency that Kim radiated was enough to let that conscious energy dissipate in its environment or stop the residual energy from imprinting on the environment. Neat stuff, I'm telling you. And we went about talking about unexplained noises, and I gotta really say that when it comes to noises, if you think that strange noises is evidence of a place being haunted, you gotta get out more. Any house that you ever live in, any apartment, any condo, if you live in a cardboard box, strange noises are going to be a part of your life for the whole thing. There's never going to be a moment where you can identify every single noise in your environment. When Lynette and I were having dinner, she heard an explosion. She's like, "Did you hear that? It was an explosion." Or, "Was it thunder rumbling in the sky?" Because I said, "I think that was thunder." Oh, put it right at ease, even though I know it was somebody probably robbing a bank, blowing it up, and the murderers were coming our way, but I was hoping to take out said murderers and then steal the bank money for myself, and since I'm not the one who committed the crime, but got the cash, you know, I kind of win in the end. But strange noises, that's not going to do it. To say that makes a place haunted, that's ignorant. It really is. You can't count on it. Hearing voices, well, I've talked about this on previous shows. Hearing voices can be a good indication that a place might be haunted. But as I found it out doing a long investigation down in Williamson County, Illinois, sometimes the voices you hear, well, they're not ghostly. They're broadcasted on AM. You never know what could take place. You know, I did an investigation at a house that the lightning rod connected to the chimney running down into the ground somehow, some way, created from the pipes that were in the house and the plaster walls and the shake, created speakers. And the radio station that was 3 miles away, when they were broadcasting their late night pre-records, some of these waves would attack, would hit that lightning rod and broadcast those sounds throughout the house. You could never quite make out the sound. And of course, this goes into the Rorschach test. You know, the Rorschach test is an inkblot test. But the Rorschach test is more than just an inkblot test. It's the fact that your brain is magical in the sense that it wants an answer for something. So if you hear a random noise or you think you hear somebody speaking, you're going to listen intently to what they're saying. And if the words are close, if it's just close, you might say, oh my God, it said get out. Oh my God, it said get out. Oh my God, oh my God. That happens a lot when people are coached, when people are led into believing. You know, people will say, hey, listen to this EVP. What you're going to hear is this. They're not going to give you an opportunity to listen to the EVP, create your own opinion on what you may have heard. Also, usually when somebody plays an electronic voice phenomena piece for you, they're usually playing you like the 5-10 seconds of the clip. They're not going to explain the environment they were in. They're not going to give you a nice, colorful detail of what the situation was. And they're not going to play 2 minutes before the EVP and 2 minutes after the EVP, because then you may figure out that it's a bunch of horse shit and it's not really an EVP. Or it was a, because we have lots of EVP experts out there who do everything from TVs to conventions and people that just call themselves EVP experts because it sounds like a pretty bitchin' title, that like to pre-record their EVPs and then just swap out the recorder's nice bait and switch later so they can play it for the crowds, for the masses, and they can go, you guys were all here when we asked these questions, right? Yeah, we were. Look it, we got an EVP, and they play it. Because they rehearsed what they were going to say, down to making jokes with one another, recorded it, put it on the stupid-ass recorder, and then played it for you. And people fall for it. Not you, though. Fans of liveparanormal.com understand that the opinions of Paranormal Uncensored are not the opinions of liveparanormal.com. Which is fine. Because if they were, there'd probably be about 95% less shows on this website. But to each their own. We can agree to disagree. Does anybody have any questions about what I talked about tonight? I mean, this is Paranormal Uncensored. I'm Jason Sullivan. Our topic tonight is what makes a haunt and what exactly is hauntings, basically. And we kind of went over some things. We cracked a couple of jokes and talked serious about a few subjects. But, I mean, does anybody have any questions in relevance to what I've been talking about?